all of you, and thanks for the introduction, Ms. Pragati. And today we are going to discuss about the topic is, how will I know if my child is improving? And before we proceed, just give me a minute and then we'll start the session. Yeah, so I would like to know how many of you are attending this webinar for the first time, my session for the first time. Okay, and just type me in the chat box if you're attending for the first time. Only those who are attending for the first time, please type me in the chat box. And would you, am I clear? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, okay. And would you like to this webinar to be interactive or something like a monologue where I do all the talking? Or do you want this to be a two-way interaction? And how can we make a webinar more interactive is by your active participation in terms of the chat box. Okay, we have something very unique or very specific for this. We have a chat box. So I would be giving you some, asking you some questions time and again, and you will be giving me your reply in the chat box. Is it okay with everybody? Please type okay in the chat box if you are okay with that. Yeah, okay. I would like to have a few more okays. Yeah, so that's fine. Thank you very much. So it's a meeting you, all of you, on a Friday evening. And I'm Karthik Rao, and this is probably my second webinar for Moms Believe. We had one earlier in, I think, around May or June, in which we spoke about how to make activities more innovative and how to be customizing it. And today we are going to discuss more about, it's more slightly a different topic than what you would typically encounter when we talk about these webinars, because this is not a technique-oriented topic or a strategy-oriented topic, but this is something which is much more holistic, because in this we are going to discuss about how will I know if my child is progressing or not. Okay, so that is what would be the discussion today. And are you excited about this topic? Did you think that it was something new or something would be useful? You never thought of that. Okay, did you think like that? Are you excited? Just type E in the chat box if you feel it's a new topic. Okay, because something that is not commonly discussed, and especially with parents, because there's always a lot of content being discussed with therapists as such, but with parents, people do not talk a lot about research and identifying changes. Yeah. So this is something that I had in my mind, and I thought, like, let it be something that would be useful for parents as well, because none of us, none of the therapists, none of the experts, whatever maybe the years of experience, can claim that I know everything about the child. Do you all agree with me on that? Please type A in the chat box. Okay? None of us, nobody in the world can say, I know all about autism. I know all about ADHD. I am the expert. I am the best in the world. I know everything and I can do everything. Yeah? So, why is it almost impossible? First of all, the law. There's room for improvement, and the same, every child has a unique kind of issue. The same child with same tactile seeking may show it in two different ways. And then there is the social economical factor, there's a cultural factor, there's the economic and the financial aspects of it. And so everything plays a role in the child's development. How is the parent talking to the child? How much is the environment helping the child? And everything has its role. So what needs to be done is, we always need to have an open mind. We always need to understand that I may not know the solution, but there is a way I can find it out. Okay, so that is the positive thinking there. I may not know the solution right now. I may have worked with different kids at different points of time, and I have tried a lot of things which has worked, and I've also tried a lot of things which have not worked at all. Okay, and then I realize, okay, this is not the right way to go. And once you do that, and then you understand that But I was eventually able to find certain strategies here and there, and then you were able to do it. Okay, so let's get into the presentation. Okay, so this would be the discussion today, in which we are talking about how will I know if my child is improving. Okay, and because we do a lot of things for our kids, and then we need to know whether are we going in the right direction or not. I'm sure all of you have this question in your mind, whether am I going in the right direction, and how will I know that? As a parent of a child with special needs, you do so many different things. You are spending a lot of time for your child. You are working with the child, you're playing with the child, you're taking care of their daily activities, they're dependent on you. And then once you identify the child has a special need, and then you do a lot of searching for therapists, for centers, for special schools, and then you learn about what is this. The first diagnosis is always like you go to Dr. Google and then try to find out like what is the problem and what does it mean. Because for many of us, many parents especially, I would say this would be the first time when you heard something like a term called autism or ADHD. Only when you heard the diagnosis, only if you had come across such a term in your life. How many of you agree with me on that? Special needs, disability, cerebral palsy, or any it could be any diagnosis, or just it could be a developmental delay. And so how many of you agree with me on that this was the first time you actually thought there is something like this? Okay, if you have gone through that, then I would say that you're not alone, definitely. And that is so that you immediately go to Google and then try to find out what is it happening. Okay, what is this condition? How long will it take? What are the problems? How do they identify? What are the treatment options available? And things like that. So there's a lot of time that you spend on this. And many of you also do courses. You become special educators, you become psychologists, ABA therapists, and things like that. And the next thing that you also invest is your health, or rather say you are not able to invest in your health because there's no me time for parents. And then you understand me time. Can you just type me time in the chat box if you understand what I mean by that? There is no specific time for you. You want to watch a movie, you want to do some exercise, you want to talk to your friends and things like that. And then you are not able to spend time for all of that because the daily routine is so demanding for you. Yeah, so you understand me time. And you continue with your pains and aches because it's like, it's in other terms, I would say that it's a niggle. And so you think it'll go on its own and things like that. And then you put a lot of effort, you do a lot of study, you prepare some customized materials. I could be one of the culprits there, because whenever I have some issues with a kid, and then I tell, and most of the time in my sessions, in my clinical sessions, parents are there with me, because then I tell them that what is I'm doing and what is the child responding, how am I modifying. And then many times it so happens that whatever toy or equipment that I have is not customized. Okay, I may try to customize it to the best way possible, but there are certain limitations to that. And so then I tell the parent, okay, can you make something like this? I want a sheet, I want these marks, but I don't want this external or extra information that is available in this sheet and things like that. So parents do that. They all go out of the way, they go back home, they create a cardboard and cut a cardboard and create some materials which will help the child as well. So you prepare a lot of customized, TLM stand for teaching learning materials. Okay, teaching learning material. So you do a lot of that, and then you organize your schedule. And then you look at your travel plans, because you go to therapy centers, probably I'm talking about something before COVID. You travel from school to then to come back home, have lunch, go to the therapy center, come back home. There's a lot of traveling involved. Sometimes you visit to far off places to consult people. And then it's all money as well, right? In India, most of the time there's no insurance. And so everything goes out of pocket. So a lot of effort goes into the development of a child with special needs. Do you think I have summed it up? Okay, please type S for summing it up. Okay, am I able to connect with you? I'm able to understand you. Yeah. So much of time, effort, health expenses. I mean, you're neglecting your health. the travel and money and all those things are so much demanding. So it's definitely a big challenge to be a special parent. Now, my question is, obvious, then when we are doing so much for our child, then the big question would be, is it worth it? Do you all agree with me with this question? With this question, please type Q in the chat box. Okay. Q in the chat box. Is it all worth it? Because you are doing so much for a child, and definitely it's good for the child, but we definitely want to know whether we are going in the right direction or not. So that could be the main thing, and that is what we're going to discuss about it today. And how do we find an answer to this? So the best way to get an answer for this particular question is to measure it. Okay, we need to identify what needs to be done, what is the child's behavior and all of that. But the first thing is, we need to know what is the current level of the child. And how do we identify? Now, when you go to a therapist, when you go to a psychologist, anybody, they may do some standardized assessments. Okay, I'm sure you would have heard about assessments like IQ. Okay, you would have heard assessment about sensory profile or GMFM and things like that. So these are all standardized assessments which are done by professionals. Okay, and they have its own advantages. Okay, but as a parent, we would also like to know, can I check what I'm trying to do? Is it helping the child or not? Because all of us have our own unique style of working with a kid, and every child is also unique. So we need to know, when I'm trying to teach a child, should I keep the object in front of him or should I keep it on the side? Did you have these kind of questions? Should I be type PQ? PQ means parent questions, okay? Because I already listed down the questions, I'm just asking you a different term to write. Parent questions, because whenever you are working with a child, you'll have so many questions coming up. Should I be straight? Should I be soft? Should I be making him sit on a table, a chair and write? Or because he seems to be writing better on the floor, and should I use that as a floor and a desk? So you have so many questions that comes up. Okay, should I sit in front of him and tell him what to do? Or should I sit on the side? Should I give him instructions from the back? Okay, so a lot of questions that comes up, and I'm sure this is very what I've told you is very sample question, very few of that. But when you start working with kids, there are a lot of questions that comes to our mind. And so what we are going to do is, we are going to measure everything. So if you cannot measure it, you cannot improve it, and that is what is called understanding today. If you are not, and that means, just let me take a few seconds here. It shows that my internet connection is slow, and I have just for a backup, I'm also using my phone. I've also logged in through my phone, so if anything wrong happens, I can definitely use my phone to discuss with you. Okay, so if you cannot measure it, you cannot improve it. Do you agree with me on this particular statement? Please type A. Many times what will happen is, when you ask somebody, tells you like, how is your child? And then you say like, no, this child is good, he's improving, he's better. Okay. But many times we are not able to clearly tell you why it is. Okay. Or what is the change that is happening. And many times it is a qualitative change that we are mentioning. It's not a quantitative change. Okay. Qualitative change means like good, better, best. I have some kind of adjective which I'm using. I cannot really say that he's 10% better, he's 10 times better. Okay, I cannot say that. I can only say, we may use it just like that, but that is not a very scientific way of doing it. And what you will see is, when we try to do something like that, we always use a qualitative term. He's better than yesterday, he's better than last week, or and he's improving, he's showing good responses. Okay, so the good responses, the improving and all those things are qualitative terms. And what we would like to know is that really, because now what is problem with qualitative is, it becomes subjective. Okay, subjective means what is good for me, it may not be good for you. Okay, if you understand this term, please write sub, S for subjective. Subjective means what I can feel, I can see. Objective means what everyone can see. Okay. Subjective means I feel it. I feel that my child is improving. I feel that he started using more words. I feel that he's showing a better eye contact. Okay. These are all subjective opinions. Okay. But what I would also like to know is there an objective way of it? Can I show it to the world, or can I show it not maybe to the world, at least to my family members that who have been telling me that there's no point in going to a speech therapist or no point in going for OT. They tell them that, see, this was his attention span. Now his attention span is this much. It was 5 minutes earlier. Now he's able to sit for 30 minutes. And I have that data with me. Okay. Wouldn't that be nice to have? Okay. So this is what we're going to discuss. And why do we have to measure? Okay. We have to measure for two main reasons. One would be, we would like to measure, is the child progressing or not? Is there an improvement in the child's ability or not? That is one reason. That is, and there is this one more reason, and that is, what is it that is helping the child? Okay, what is it that is helping the child improve? Do you think we need answer to both? If yes, then please type B. Do you think both these questions are equally important? Type B. Because if I only focus on progress, the child is improving, and I don't really know what strategy is working, which therapist is helping, because many times you go to different people, one speech, one OT, and things like that, then what will happen is, what is it that is actually helping the child? We are not sure. And it's very difficult to pinpoint it as well. Okay, so then we need to understand that it is not just enough that I understand the child is improving or not, but I also need to understand what particular strategy that is being followed is helping the child. And so we have so many questions with us. We need to know what treatment is effective. Okay, whether it is ABA, whether it is sensory integration, whether it could be your PECS approach or your AAC. Okay, or it could be depending on what you're trying. What treatment is effective by whom? By which person? Because two professionals, both who are equally qualified, who have the same amount of training, will interact with the child in different ways. Do you agree with me on that? D, please type D in the chat box. D for different. Same qualified, they might be college mates, they might have gone everywhere together, they might go to the same higher education, everything. But the way they interact, the way they communicate with the child, everything would be, it would be different. It cannot be the same. Because each of us have our own personality, each of us have our own school of thought, okay? And our own, the way we interact with kids. So we need to know by whom is effective, or for this particular individual. So we're talking about one particular child. We're not talking about diagnosis of autism, treatment of autism. We're not talking about all children with ADHD. We're talking about my child. Okay, so I want to know what is effective for my child, not for somebody else, not for a group of it. Okay, because that is where I'm concerned about with that specific problem. So I understand my child has issues with attention span. My child has issues with eye contact, or he is not able to balance. He's not able to walk independently. So that is a specific problem and under which set of circumstances. So when should I do? Should I be doing the exercises? Which is better? A home-based intervention is better, or a center-based intervention is better? Okay, so we always have so many questions related to our child. And how can we get answers to these? So if there are professionals here, then let me just quickly tell you that this topic I'm discussing is about single system design, in which we are measuring changes in the child. And we are typically, and research consists of comparing one group of people with another group. We talk about RCT and things like that. And here we are not focusing on that. We are focusing on a single subject, one particular child. And we are trying to see changes over time. And that's it right now. That's what I'm going to tell you. And let me just move further. So what are we going to do now? The first thing is I'm going to specify the problem. I'm going to say that the child has a poor attention span. Can you give me a few problems, or just one word of that? Okay, it could be attention, it could be eye-hand coordination. I've given you two words. Okay, two problem areas. Can you tell me something else? Anybody, just two or three I would like to see. attention span, it could be eye-hand coordination, registration issues, yes, hyperactivity, good one. Yeah, eye contact, yes. Yeah, one more, just one more. Yes, yeah, so those are the issues that you see. You can also talk about communication, you called about self-stimulatory behaviors, yeah, exactly. So vestibular issues, balance issues, and things like that. So we are trying to specify the problem. Thank you very much, thanks a lot. Specify the problem. So we are going to tell the child that this is the problem that I want to know. What is my child's current level? And I want to see whether my child is improving or not. Okay. Are you all clear with me? See, please type C. C in C for clear. I'm going to specify the problem. I'm going to note how can I observe it. And then I'm going to measure it. There are three steps. Specify, identify how will I know. What happens? What is the child showing that tells makes me feel that this child has a problem in that? Okay. For example, the child is not showing eye contact. So what is the problem? The not showing eye contact is the problem. What is the observable behavior? Whenever you're calling the child or whenever you're conversing with the child, okay, the child is not looking at you. So that is your observable behavior. And then how are you going to measure it? So how are we going to measure it? Probably for 10 attempts, how many times the child maintains eye contact or even just looks at me and then looks elsewhere. Okay, how many times child is able to do that? So that information, we essentially want a number. Yeah, thank you. Thanks for the inputs. So that is what we need is a number. So just please make it clear. I would want you to type the entire word number because this is the most important framework of this presentation. Please type number in the chat box, a full word number. Whatever you are trying to do, we want to convert it into number. Yeah, I'll just wait for a few seconds to see the chat box. Thank you all. I just love the way you are interacting with me and you're able to follow me, and thanks a lot for that. And so this is called a data point. This number is called a data point. And what you see here is an example of eye-hand coordination. Now I can measure eye-hand coordination so many different ways. Okay, how many times the child is able to catch a ball? How many times the child is able to stack? How many blocks he is able to stack? I hope you have heard of a game called Jenga. And I'm going to check the child. I want the child to stack the blocks, just a single row, one on top of the other. And I want the child to do that. And I'm going to check how many blocks he can measure. Okay, how many blocks he can keep. Now that is an example of eye-hand coordination. So there are different forms of measuring the same problem area. Okay, so please type D for different ways of measurement. Okay, so do not assume that I'm talking about eye-hand coordination, then I can do only this way. Okay, there are so many different ways of doing it. And that may vary from child to child, may vary from what you are doing, where you are doing it, everything plays a role in that. And what you see here is I'm going to measure eye hand coordination for one particular child by drawing a line, which is my black line. And then I'm going to ask a child to trace it with a red color pen. And I'm going to measure the distance the red color line comes outside the black line. So that is my measurement. That's my measuring criteria. How long do you think this will take? How long will it take? I'm going to probably have three lines and ask the child to measure. Okay, I'll try to draw three separate lines, not like a continuation. It's three separate lines. And I want to go and ask the child to measure. I just want the child to trace it. How long do you think this will take my time? In a day. I'm going to give a paper to the child, okay? And this paper will have three lines and the child has to trace. Few minutes. Yes, maximum 2 minutes, I would say. Okay, even lesser than that. If the child is attentive and doing well. So just a few minutes, just 2 minutes per day. And that is all you have to spend, okay? And then I'm going to just measure how much the deviation was, and I'm going to add. Now there are different ways of it. You can add it, you can find an average and things like that. but I would prefer to add it because the line length of the line is constant. So I'm going to give the same line every day. So I would prefer better add it. So that would give me a more reliable result. So I'm going to add it. And then that would be my data point for that particular day. And once I am able to do that, I'm able to note it down and find out what is the child's performance over a period of time. Okay. So the next thing that I do is I'm going to understand what to measure. Now, just now I said like I can do addition, I can do different ways of it. Now there are a few ways in which you can measure. Okay, you can either measure using the frequency. Frequency means how many times the child is doing it. The child is mouthing objects. Okay, how many times in a day? How many times within half an hour? How many times during writing session? Okay, the child who does not try to write, he is breaking the pencil lid. Okay, now how many times is he doing it? Okay, and in a session or in a day or in a week, you can note it down. Yeah, so some other issues like vestibular attention distraction. Yeah, so whatever it is, that's what I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to identify, there are different ways of measuring it. One would be frequency. Okay, and frequency can also mean like how many times the child is falling when the child has to walk from point A to point B. Let's say if the distance is 10 feet and we are practicing the walking balance for a child with cerebral palsy, then we need to know like how many times is the child losing balance. So then, or it could be duration. We can look at the duration of attention span. If the child is getting distracted frequently, then I'm going to look at what is the duration of attention for that particular child. So here I'm going to take down the time as a factor. Or it could be percentage. When I talk about percentage, I'm looking at out of 10. Let's say I'm giving an activity like a target throw. I'm asking a child to throw a ball at a target and the object has to fall down. And how many times was he successful? And then I say like he was successful 8 out of 10 times. That is 80%. Okay, so these are different ways of measurement. Am I clear on that? I'll talk about the grading later. Am I clear on that? Just type C in the chat box. There are different ways to measure, and this measurement will also vary on what you're measuring. Okay, because if it is something related to attention span, then duration is a better option. When it is something related to a particular behavior, then I can go for frequency is a better option. If I'm looking at how consistent the child is or how successful the child is, then percentage is a better option. Okay, it depends on what you want to measure. So ask yourself, are we measuring what we want to measure? Okay, sometimes it could be misleading. Okay, so it's important that we always try to be clear, are we measuring what we want to measure? Now, let me give you an example of grading. We can also create our own grading system in which we find out whether the child is improving or not. Now, this is something which I have developed. It's we call it as a compliance grading. So I'm going to check like what is the levels of a child. Okay, when I'm trying to teach him something or make him do something, is he cooperating or not cooperating? Okay, and so I look at this. The child likes, so level one would be the child dislikes the activity and does not allow the task. He does not allow me to do it, is resisting too much, and I'm not being successful. Then level two is slightly better. The child dislikes the activity, but does it due to compulsion. I have to force the child, push him and compel him to do it. And then the child is able to do that. Third level, the child is cooperative, but most of the work is done by the parent. Okay, so it tells you like what is the skill level of the child as well. Okay, now this child is cooperating, but the parent is doing most of the work. Level four is child does most of the work, but needs more prompts or supervision. Child is able to do, but there has to be somebody behind the child asking, did you apply soap to your hands? Did you wash your face? Did you wipe your hands or things like that? And that is your level four. And then level five is your child is independent. Okay, where there is no supervision required. Do you understand about this concept of grading? Please type G in the chat box. Yeah, so you can create your own grading to help you. So every day I'm going to measure like, is the child able to do this? How you can always restrict it to one particular activity so that you don't have to spend the entire day on that. So you focus only on, now my goal is I want the child to learn to bath, take bath independently. I'm going to follow this method. Okay, so now I'm going to focus only on bathing time, and then I say that I want the child to take the child from level 1 to level 5, and I'm going to just record what is the level today compared to yesterday. Okay, I'm just going to take a record of that. And for activities, I'll just give you one quick tip. Is for activities which require self-care training, then it is always better to do the self-care activities twice a day. Okay, which means taking bath in the morning as well as in the evening. Okay, anyway, you're going to have food at least 3 times, and so you're going to brush morning and night at least 2 times. And then if you are taking baths 2 times, you're also going to dress and undress 2 times. So you will find that when you increase the frequency of self-care activity, you will get more data points in a shorter period of time, and also you get more opportunities for to train the child. Did you like this idea? Please type L in the chat box. Again, when I say questions like, did you like? If you don't like, you don't have to type, okay? There's no hard and fast rule there, okay? But when you try and increase the frequency, it's a kind of a win-win situation. You get more opportunities to train, as well as you get, when it comes to recording it, you get 2 points on a given day. Yeah, so that means instead of checking something for 1 month, I can do the same in 15 days time as well. And it helps the child as well. Yeah, so think of that. Thank you. And some measurement tips would be, always measure at same time of the day to prevent extraneous factors like sleep, like hunger, etc., influencing the score. So which means you're measuring today in the morning, tomorrow also you should measure in the morning. After breakfast, then after breakfast. Okay, always make sure you're measuring at the same time of the day, because there could be additional factors which can interfere with the scoring, and then you will think that your child is not responding, the child is not going in the right direction because you're getting altered scores. But in reality, that is not the case. In reality, the problem is the child is sleepy, he's hungry, and you're done at different points of time, so it is not giving you a reliable score. Okay, please type RS. RS for reliable score. To increase the reliability of this measure, we need to do this. And also specify environment settings. We have to specify which room I did, who has to do it, whether it's the mother or the father or a sibling or a grandparent, and should be in the hall, should be in the dining room, drawing room, or small place for the child. So everything has to be noted down. Okay, this will improve the reliability of your data point. Okay. And then we are going to measure. We are going to just check it down. Are we measuring what we want to measure? That's what I had told you earlier. And now we are going to look at, when you have decided this is what I'm going to measure, and then I'm going to write it down. Okay. What is the advantage of writing down? Is when I'm writing something, I become very clear in my thought. Okay. When I'm just thinking about it, let me do it sometime or things like that, I'm not very clear in my thought. But the moment I write it down, I become much more clear. Okay, let me just take you, I'm just going to read through this to give you that clarity. Attention span, if I'm going to measure attention span means the duration of time the child is able to focus on a task. Okay, the time he is able to focus on a task with a time gap for distraction not more than 5 seconds. Now, why do I say a point of distraction? Just now, my son came inside, and so that was a distraction for me, and as I'm talking here. Now, what I need to do is, if I'm getting distracted, I should be able to come back to the task. That is an adaptive way of distraction. This is good. Okay, it is not like anybody can come in and I'm not going to turn, I'm going to just focus on this. That is not adaptive, that is not good for living. We always have to be adaptive, because there could be something which is much more important for me to attend than talking in a webinar. Do you agree with me on that? So we have to be adaptive. Please type AD, AD for adaptive. So distraction is good, but what I'm going to look at is the child able to come back into the task without prompt? Okay. So we have to have a fine balance there. Okay, so that would be my checkpoint. So it is okay if he's turning around when somebody is coming, I'm just turning around and watching who is it. And then I realize that that has nothing to do with me. And so I can continue with my work. Okay, so that would be my time gap of distraction not more than 5 seconds, and the child is able to return to the activity without being reminded. So that tells you how much focus the child had and how much of a responsibility the child has towards this activity. The recording will stop when the child looks elsewhere, initiates a conversation unrelated to the context, like I'm talking about something else, you want me to write, and suddenly I remember what happened last week and I'm talking about that. So those are all signs that the child doesn't want to do it. Okay, fiddles with objects or toys, expresses in some other way, that indicates there's need for discontinuation. And when you see all of that, it tells you that the child does not want to do that, and then you stop your recording. If there's something external, I will give the 5 second leeway to the child. Okay, do you think writing helps? Okay, please type H. Are you getting a clarity with this statement? Please type H. It's a very simple way of writing in English. Okay, you can also write in your own regional language. Doesn't make any difference at all. But writing down makes it easy for us to know, put our thoughts into action, and it helps us to be more focused with that. And the other advantage of writing is, today I'm not going to check it. I'm going to ask somebody else to check it for me, because I have to go to office or some meeting or some wedding or something like that. Then I can always tell you, like, this is what I'm doing. Please have a look at it. And this is how you're going to check. Please do it. Okay. So it helps to pass on that information to another person also. They also get that clarity. Yeah. Thank you. And always remember, you can define it after a couple of trials. Be prepared for modifying it after a couple of trials, because whenever you try to do something, there is always a possibility that you had not taken certain things into account. Like you would have thought, like, I'm going to make this child sit in a particular room and then every day at 6 p.m. Okay, but you did not realize that at 6 p.m. this room is very close to a mosque or something, where they have a religious place where they make some announcement at exactly at 6 p.m. Okay, so then be prepared to change it. You had not taken that into account. Or it could be like, right now in my house, we are trying to struggle for a room, because as I'm talking in a webinar, I want a closed room. I don't want any distractions. And now my son has some online classes. He's going for a singing class, and everything has become online now, not just the academic part. And now he also wants a room. And therefore, there's a lot of conflict as well. So sometimes when you start doing something, then you always look at give yourself a couple of days to see how it is panning out, and then modify it accordingly. When I started thinking about this, I chose to look at, I usually travel with my motorcycle to my clinic. It is like almost eight, 9 kilometers from my house, and takes around 25 minutes for me to travel. And it's so boring. Traveling every day for 25 minutes on a motorcycle alone is very boring. And so I thought, like, let me make it interesting. Okay, so I thought, okay, why shouldn't I count how many people I'm able to overtake? And that is something that I started to measure, because that is something would keep myself occupied. And I wanted to just know, like, how many people I'm able to overtake at my own speed, and things like that. So then when I started doing that, then there were a few variables that started popping up. Okay, because now certain people I was overtaking, and they were overtaking me. Okay, so it was like, should I deduct it or not? Okay, that was one question. And there was sometimes it was like, I'm near the signal. And as you know, motorcycles near signal, we always go from around it. Okay, we don't get into the main things. So now at this point of time, I am actually overtaking around 20 vehicles at the same time. Should I consider that? And I cannot really count how many vehicles are there. It's too much of a task, right? And doesn't really help me to decide anything. So then is it worth it? Okay, so these are some questions that comes to your mind. And this is something which you had not taken into account when you started it, isn't it? Do you agree with me on that? Did you like this example? Okay, please type E in the chat box. Example of measuring how many people I crossed. Is it, when I say did you like it, I'm just asking you, like, did you find this relevant to what we are discussing? Okay. So you will know that only when you actually get into the act. Without doing that, you will not know it. That is my point. Okay. Yeah. So thank you very much. And now once we have the data point, we are going to put it in a chart or a graph or some visual way of knowing it, so that we know whether this is an improvement or no improvement, because just like looking at numbers, we may not get a very clear idea. Okay, so we put it in a chart or a graph format. And the next question is, are you all clear till this? Whatever I've spoken? Is all, please type CC, crystal clear. Let's make it more innovative and interesting. Yeah, CC. And I hope I don't have to repeat anything right now. Yeah, so that gives me the green signal to proceed. Thank you very much. And now the next question. So we have modified, we have understood about how am I going to measure, what am I going to measure, how am I going to write it down, how am I going to record it, and how am I going to represent it in the visually way, because once you put it in a graph, it becomes easy for everyone to see. This is what it was earlier, now it is, this is what you see right now. So it becomes easier. Now the next question is, how to know which treatment is effective? Okay, because now I know my child is improving, but I want to know what is it that helped him to improve, because I want to continue, and I would recommend that to somebody else also. And it is also possible that I would try that particular strategy in other things as well. Now this strategy, an OT is using a particular strategy which makes your child more compliant and cooperative, and you want to know, like, would it be nice if I use this strategy in speech therapy also? Okay, so then I would also like to know why or which part of the treatment is effective, or which part of the strategy or approach is effective, so that I can use it in other spheres, and so that the development is much more faster, and it's like I have found out the formula. Okay, so that is what we are going to look at. And so we look at some designs. Okay, these are called AB designs. These are like basically a research based tool. And so these are AB, ABA, and these are different types of designs. And what is this basically is, I'm going to collect information over two periods of time. Okay, the first period is a baseline or no treatment period. So which means I want to know what is my child's attention span, because now this is a COVID situation, I'm not going to able to go to a therapist. And so I want to know what is my child's current attention span. And when the therapy session starts, I want to know what is my child's attention span then. If I have two sets of periods, then I can compare. And then I would know, is his attention span improving, and is that because of therapy? Okay, so I have different, I have a baseline or no treatment period or a treatment period. Now let us look at this example. This is the response pattern of a mentally retarded child. This is a 2006 document. So now we talk in terms of intellectual disability. So excuse me for that. Of a mentally retarded patient showing changes in weight over a baseline period and a period of oral motor intervention. So what they have done is they have measured weight of a child every week. It's not every day, it is every week they have measured the weight of a person, and then they have done some oral motor intervention. Okay, and what they have found out is the baseline period is what you see, and the B is a period of oral motor intervention. So without intervention and with intervention. And this is what they have found out. And then you can clearly see that the intervention period shows a very consistent improvement in weight gain. Okay, so this, and now what is a ABA design? You're going to repeat the A period again. No treatment, treatment, no treatment. Or ABAB, you can, the more number of times you repeat it, the more sure you become, this is only because of this. Okay, because what will happen, can somebody tell me, okay, what is the flip side, or what can go wrong in an AB design? I'm just looking at the chat box. What can go wrong in an AB design? When I say go wrong, I mean like you get the data, you see some changes, but it's not a true change. I'll just take a couple of seconds for you. I mean, probably 10 seconds around to see if I get some responses. It's not so easy to type as well, I understand. What can go wrong? Okay, fine. let me just give you, if somebody's typing, please go ahead. I'll acknowledge that as well. Okay, so what can go wrong in an A/B design is there can be some variables which you have not taken into consideration. That's a good guess. Regression is a good guess. Yeah, so in one assessment, we might not have considered other environmental factors. Exactly. Yeah, so there can be certain variables which you are not taken into account, or which there are certain variables which you on which you do not have a control. Okay, now the COVID is something, a very classical example. You do not have any control over that. And so what is happening is you had your plans, but your plans went awry, but you continued with your measurement. But now you don't know, the child has improved. Is it because he is now at home and he is spending more time with his family members because everyone is at home and they're talking and interacting well with the child? Is this the reason for improvement, or is it because you have given some home program, or you have done some courses, or you are trying to implement that? Because that is a plan. There, during this A to B conversion, during this A to B transition, there has been one more factor which was not planned and which was not in your control. It could be very silly things. Like, for example, suddenly a grandparent has started, has moved, and they're staying with you. Probably they came for a week, and then because of COVID, they could not go back, and they got, because of the lockdown. It could be you have shifted from your residence from one area to another area. Here there were no kids. There were in the other society or colony, there are so many kids who are interacting well with the child. Do you agree with me with these things? Please type A in the chat box. There can be some variables which cannot be accounted for and which can contribute to the result, and therefore this A/B design alone may not be a very reliable design when it comes to kids. Okay, when we also look at these designs, when you look at give a Facebook ad and things like that, but there it is much more reliable compared to this. And so that's why we need a A/B. If you are clear with B/A/B design, what is B/A/B design? Please type B/A/B. I'm not getting your question about the feedback form. Yeah. Okay, so if you're clear with what is a B/A/B, then please type B/A/B in the chat box. Then I will tell you what is B/A/B. We have four designs: A/B, A/B/A, A/B/A/B, B/A/B, and multiple. So let's forget about multiple. Let's focus on this. If you're able to guess what is B/A/B, then I will tell you what is B/A/B. Please type B/A/B in the chat box. That's an easy way of asking you, isn't it? Asking you, instead of asking you a big sentence like, why is this happening? Then if you understand B/A/B, just type it. That's some learning that I'm getting right now. Okay, so now this B/A/B design. Yeah, so B/A/B is you're starting with intervention period, then there's a period of non-intervention, and then you go for intervention. That is B/A/B. Okay, so B is intervention period. A is a non-intervention period, and then you go for intervention period. So sometimes you do that, you start treatment, and then there is a break, and then you continue. I hope it is clear now. So this would be a B/A/B design. This is a response pattern of the ability to swallow liquid without loss, oromotor intervention. So they're able to swallow and they're not able to, there's no coming out. Okay, so it's not without loss during oromotor intervention and period of no intervention. And then they are measuring it. Probably they're measuring by the volume in a bowel or something, and about the loss of liquid. Okay, so this is another example. So can we measure anything? That would be the next question. Okay, can we measure anything then? Though what we have to understand is, if we are able to observe, then we can measure. What cannot be observed cannot be measured. Okay, and I'm going to ask you some questions. You have to tell me whether we can measure this. Okay, can you observe this? Can you observe attention span? Can you observe attention span? Please type yes or N. N for no, Y for yes. Y for yes, N for no. Okay. Thank you. Yes, we can measure or observe attention span. Can you observe speech delay? Yes or no? Y for yes, N for no. Okay, I'm going to give you a small trick here. I'd say no. I'm going to explain. Please hold on why I'm saying no. Yeah, so yes, I know, but right now it's no. Eye to eye contact. Eye to eye contact. Can you measure? Yes or no? 10 counts. Okay. It's like going like a game show. Yeah. Eye to eye contact. Yes, you can measure eye to eye contact. Eye hand coordination. It's a no brainer. I've already spoken about that. the question paper is out. Yeah. So you measure eye hand coordination. Immature for age. The child, many times parents tell me, the child is acting immature for age. The child has a poor attitude. The child has, he's delayed, he's retarded and things like that. Yeah, we cannot measure. Okay. Again, I'm telling you yes and no. The conditions apply. Can you measure balance? Yes. Mouthing. Yeah. Yes, we can measure mouthing. Poor attitude towards learning. You're trying to teach something to the child and the child is not willing to learn. Yes, I would say no. Okay, now why am I saying no? I am sure you would have been confused or you think otherwise. It's perfectly fine. And I'll give you my explanation for this. Why can't you measure these things? You're talking about speech delay, immature for age and poor attitude. All these are non-specific. Okay, we are not exactly telling you what is it. Okay, for example, if it is like I'm measuring how many words the child is able to say, it is easy to measure. Okay, but when it's a speech delay, it's not easy to measure. I'm not talking about from a professional point of view where you do some standardized assessment, then you get some normative data, you compare with other group of people, and then you say that this child is delayed by 6 months, 3 months, 2 years, and things like that. I'm not talking about those things. I'm talking about from a parent perspective. Okay, so when you say speech delay, immature for age, and things like that, then what is it really reflecting is I'm not being very specific. Okay. And so it is non-specific and non-observable. Somebody is asking for feedback form. I'm not very sure. Can somebody from Moms Belief answer that?
The feedback form will be sent to your on your mail ID by 6 p.m. After 5 minutes, you'll get the feedback form.
Yes, we'll get a feedback form in your mail ID. Thank you very much. Yeah. So then how do you know this? So how do you know there's a speech delay? So that is what we're going to come discuss about. How do you know the child is immature for it? What makes you think that? Okay, then what behaviors did you observe that made you conclude these things? And whatever you have observed, can you record it? Is this point clear? Please type C for clear. Why you cannot measure? Because it is non-specific and non-observable. But what made you think like that in the first place? You have to go back to that and then see, can you observe and measure it? Yeah, when I talk about speech delay, when I talk about immature for age or poor attitude towards learning, these are very non-specific. How do I say, if somebody tells me that this child has poor attitude towards learning, and then, okay, I'm going to work on that. after 3 months I say now your child's attitude has improved. How do I say that? It's not possible. Okay, so why is it not possible? Because it is non-specific. But as I told you different examples, like how quicker the child is able to, now how do I measure attitude when it comes to learning or writing? Then I note down how quicker the child is able to complete a written task, how many times he breaks pencil. Okay, now always remember when you're trying to measure, if it is a good behavior, we want the graph to increase. If it's a bad behavior or undesirable behavior, we want the graph to decrease. Okay, please type I and D if you're clear with that. I, D. Okay, it's not like every graph should be pointing up, because if the child is like mouthing objects and he's mouthing 20 times in 10 minutes, then I want this to come down. So then the graph should actually point downwards. Okay, but if it is something like the child's attention span, then I want the graph to increase, because then that tells me his attention span has increased. Okay, so I'm going to check about the attitude towards learning. So what makes me feel that his attitude is poor? When I call him, he does not come and sit for the session, or when I ask him to write, he is like looking around, he's wasting time, or for writing one word, he takes 20 minutes or 10 minutes. So these are all signs that tells me. So then I'm going to measure that. I'm going to measure how long does the child take to write 1 5-letter word. Okay, that would be my measuring criteria. And once I measure, I'm going to give different words to the child, but all 5-letter words. Okay, different days, I'm going to note down the time. And every day I'm going to do something about it, because that is the progress. But there's also a strategy. Yeah, so I'm going to try some strategy that if you finish this, you get that. That is the way apparently the child is able to complete. If the child is able to complete faster, then you understand that this is helping. Am I clear now? Yeah, so whenever you are in doubt whether something is working or not working, always start measuring. Now, do you think you have a clarity in this presentation? Is if I have a doubt, if I'm not very sure what needs to be done, okay, or I have so many questions, I'm looking for answers all the time, should I, what is it that I'm going to do? I'm going to just take out a pen and paper, I'm going to record it something, I'm going to make it super simple and super easy so that anybody in my house can help and contribute. Okay, and I'm going to spend not more than 2 minutes per day. It's not, you don't have to be thinking, am I going to spend so much time and all of that. Probably the first day when you think about it, maybe you may spend half an hour. Yeah, my connection has got cut. I am on phone right now. Yeah, do you think it is doable? Please type do in the chat box. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm just trying to see if I can improve my connection. So I would request you to start put your questions in the chat box, and I'll start answering them while I wait for the connection. Please restrict your questions to today's discussion. If you have questions like how can I measure this, how can I measure that, then I probably can help you out. Yeah. please put your questions in the chat box. Just give me a minute. Let me see if I have to do something. Yeah, I think I'm back. Yes. What I realized because I identify like what needs to be done and how can I help parents, then parent also needs guidance in what hear me? Now, no. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. I'm talking to the phone right now. So why? Because there are a lot of things that parent wants to know, like how to interact with the child and things like that. And there is also always a changing culture which is happening right now. We are moving from a joint family system to a nuclear family where many first-time mothers do not actually know how to, in fact, some of them even don't know how to take care of the self-care activities. But we are not going to focus on that. We are going to focus more from for a child with special needs. And I always believe that ignorance is the biggest enemy. And that is something that we need to focus on. And so this 5 days parent training program, it will be, if you think that you do not have time for 5 days and all of that, don't have to worry. This will be pre-recorded videos in your WhatsApp group. So we will have an exclusive WhatsApp group for this purpose, and you will get some pre-recorded videos in that, and it will be for 15 to 20 minutes long every day, and every day there will be a Q&A session. So this will be the methodology that I'll be following. Okay, so it will be a Q&A. I'm going to answer them, The dates are September 28 to October 2. It's for 5 days. Okay, it starts on a Tuesday to Saturday. And so the last day will be on a Saturday. On the fifth day, we will have a live session. And so this will be the plan. And even the Q&A sessions will be recorded. And if you are not able to attend live, that you'll have access to that later on as well. Okay. And if you have questions which you're not able to ask during Q&A, then you can always send those questions to me and I'll be answering them during the Q&A session. Yeah. And the fees for the entire 5-day program is ₹199 only. Okay. It's not per day, it is for the entire program. It is ₹199 only. And those who are interested, I'm going to just share my contact number. You can just let me know. I'll just share my contact number and you let me know if you're interested.